Today, we're going to be speaking with Sergey Young, who is the founder of the Longevity Vision Fund and also author of the new book, The Science and Technology of Growing Young. Sergey, it's so great to have you on today.
Hi, David. Thanks for having me today.
My pleasure. So let's just jump right in. I've recently been reading, in addition to your book, the book Scale by Jeffrey West. And one of the things that Jeffrey West talks about is that when it comes to human aging, when you look mathematically at metabolic rate and a few other sort of basic factors, it seems as though the top end kind of natural lifespan, if you avoid car accidents and infectious disease and, you know, the best scenario, is about 120 years of age. Now, one of the things I find really interesting about your book is you start to talk about this in steps. You talk about living to 150. You talk about that. So you're not just jumping in and saying, as some do, 1,000 years of lifespan is very, very soon on the horizon. You're talking about incremental. So talk to us about that. I mean, how do we go from this natural limit of 100 to 120 up to 150?
Perfect. Great question. So, let's start from today. What are the options that we have today to extend our lifespan? So frankly speaking, all of them, you know, people call them boring, or my mom told me that. So it's lifestyle changes, it's early diagnostic, using power of wearables technologies. This will help us to live to 100 healthy and happy years. So that's what we can do today from today's, like, a stage of development of technology and science. This is actually pretty important because we have something exciting in the field of longevity science and technology coming to all of us in the next 10 to 20 years within what I call in the book near horizon of longevity innovation. But it's very important to stay on longevity bridge and be as healthy and happy as possible. So then in 10, 20 years time, our body and mind is worth extending its resource. So that's one. And it's like a separate part of the book. It's a bonus chapter. Twice as long as any other chapter. There's so many things you can do today. I call it 10 longevity choices. So then the second piece is a near horizon of longevity innovation. And again, this is technologies and scientific breakthroughs, which will be available to all of us in the next 10, 15, 20 years. And when people ask me what are the most exciting from this list, I'm always talking about gene editing and gene therapy, organ regeneration, our ability to regrow and replace organs inside our body, similar to what we do with the old car, extending its resource, and longevity in the pill. In the next 10 years, we'll have a completely new class of drugs, which will focus on aging at its core rather than any particular disease. This is the kind of drugs that we have today. So that's, again, near horizon of longevity. And then there's something more on the horizon. It's called far horizon of longevity innovation. And I'm talking about technologies which will be available to us in the next 25 to 50 years from now. And this is when man and machine will become one. When we talk about integration between computer power and human intellect, and without changing the definition of human, it's going to be very difficult to live beyond 120 or 150 years. So
let's stop there for a second, because that's really important. So you seem to be acknowledging that there is this sort of metabolic and cellular natural ceiling to human longevity that is going to need some more major change or intervention in order to be extended significantly.
Yes. So what we can do within the current biological view on the human body, biological perspective, has a limit. Whether it's 100 or 120 or 130 years, I don't know, but it's obviously in this field. So then we would need to complement the biological perspective and engineering or technological perspective and look at the integration of this for us to be able to live longer. But the bigger question is not the science and not in technology. The biggest question is ethics and regulation. Because we have created technology to extend our lives, David, but we haven't created life that we want to extend. 60 to 80% of people in the world, depending on the country, would say no to life extension opportunities. So we will need to sort out a lot of ethical issues and almost create a new amazing version of this world and society for us to embrace the idea of longer living. I call it morality of immortality. And this is my biggest worry. This is my biggest concern. This is where we need to have a conversation about ethical choices before we embrace the technology.
Yeah, well, you know, I've interviewed longevity researcher Aubrey de Grey several times over the last 15 or so years. And he often makes news for the things that are more salacious that he says, like the first person to live to 1,000 has already been born or something like that. And, you know, maybe that's true, maybe it's not. But that what I find more interesting about what he says are when I bring up the ethical considerations, how triage considerations change if the upper limit of life is extended, or what is the economic impact? What is the environmental impact of people living so much longer? He says it sort of will mostly work itself out. Like if people live a lot longer, the birth rate will go down, for example. What do you think about that?
So I do believe that there's so many things that we need to change in this world for us to be able to enjoy this far horizon of longevity. So a few of them, like I do believe longevity and longevity technology has an opportunity to become a unifying theme for the nation and for society, because someone needs to close inequality gap, which is widening all the time. So my mission is to bring affordable and accessible version of digital healthcare and technology to the world. I'm not interested to create something for the rich ones, right? So that's one. Second is this whole relationship with Mother Nature. As you pointed out, when you live 75 years, there's always a temptation to say, okay, I'm going to die in 20 years from now. Next generations will sort it out for themselves. If you're going to live 120, 150 years, I do believe that it gives us an opportunity to be much more responsible in our relationship with the planet, with the Mother Nature, because we're going to face the consequences of our own actions. Or the other thing is, and it's probably the final comment on the ethical side, is social constructs. You know, this binary social constructs that we have today, like career, marriage, retirement, they've been developed in a society where the average lifespan was 35 years. Like 2/3 of the marriages are going through divorce in the first 5 years of their life. And this is not great. And we would need to come up with a variety of the options for, you know, two people in this world to be, you know, to fix their responsibility for like kids growing or anything else. Or this whole career thing, a retirement thing. It's all so binary. It's just you work full time and then you like full time retire. And two most dangerous years of your life is the year of your birth, because we still have this high infant mortality, and year of your retirement, because you lose in today's binary framework, full-time work, full-time retirement, people lose the opportunity for social realization. And this is one of the, you know, most important component of you, your desire, willingness, and ability to live longer. So we just need to rethink, can I have as many careers as decades in my life? I need to have an answer to this question, and our society needs to be ready and change itself and its norm to accommodate this.
Yeah, that's a very interesting social question about increased lifespans that I've read about, which is maybe both from the standpoint of career and even for some people from the standpoint of relationship, there would be more chapters, or you would plan on more chapters maybe that than people plan on now. Let me ask about a couple of other kind of finer point things. In the longevity circles, there's a lot of talk about the possibility of drugs, specific medications, providing additional lifespan. Often the diabetes medication metformin is mentioned. What is the real data on metformin as a longevity drug?
So the whole issue is that aging is not considered as disease today. So there is no regulatory framework for someone to launch metformin study, which would test particular outcome of taking metformin on a regular basis for your longevity. And this is where we are today. I do think that, you know, all of us will have an opportunity to invest more time and resources into, you know, improving our health span and lifespan when regulatory change will happen. Having said that, there's so many cases in medicine, in the history of medicine, where something has been discovered as a side effect. And apparently, this is what happened with metformin. So it's clear that for certain portion of population, certain age and relation to diabetes, metformin adds 2, 3, 4 years to the lifespan and health span. Well, the question is whether it works only for people who are in a particular risk group, like suffering from diabetes, or it works for the general population. And this is still the question that we need to resolve. So that's why I'm on the board of American Federation of Aging Research, and we're working on a trial. It's a huge trial to be launched hopefully next year in the US under FDA approval and guidance, where 3,000 people will be taking metformin, and we'll have more data in 3-5 years from now, whether we have a new class of drugs, which is looking at and focusing at aging and its core, or metformin is a great diabetes drug, but unfortunately it doesn't really have any, you know, particular positive lifespan extension effect on the other parts of population. So it's very promising, but as everything in medicine, well, let's just test this before we embrace the idea of looking at metformin. So that's why, you know, everything I talk about in a near horizon of longevity, 5, 10, 15 years from now, I'm always saying, guys, be conservative. Unless you've been advised by your doctor to take it, and it says you have a critical condition, well, let's just wait, stay on longevity bridge for 5, 10 years, and so then we can embrace and use these technologies and these scientific discoveries in much more responsible and less risky way.
Yeah, that seems eminently reasonable. And if people Google metformin longevity, they will find a lot of hyperbole that does not yet match, as you're pointing out, the data, very important. Life expectancy over the last few years is actually down slightly in the United States. And of course, we're in a pandemic that has, on average, slightly reduced life expectancy. We have big disparity based on economic situation in the United States. When you're looking longer term at longevity, what do you make of this short term reduction in life expectancy?
So it's clearly a US problem. I haven't seen any other developed nation on this planet which would show this very difficult, and I say it with a lot of love, right? Tragic situation with life expectancy. I mean, it's a smaller number. It's a decrease of 0.2 years
right
every year. And it's happened in the last 3 years out of 5 pre-pandemic. So the reasons being is something needs to change in the healthcare sector in the U.S. U.S. has the most expensive, 18% of GDP, and the most inefficient healthcare system in the world. UK, United Kingdom, spends 8% of its GDP on healthcare and has much better results. Like Singapore spent 5% of their budget GDP on healthcare. And they're on number one or number two place in the world, health span wise and lifespan wise, together with Japan. So something needs to change. And obviously there's huge impact of opioid crisis to this number. So if we will localize this problem, it's going to be better. But obviously there are a number of fundamental problems, like with obesity, with the diet of Americans, with high degree and intensity of antibiotics in the meat and fish, etc. So having said that, there is a light in the end of the tunnel, because the medicine of the future is going to be much more technology driven and based on data. So that's why I'm embracing, you know, a lot of wearables which are coming to our life. Wearables is not a convenience device for you anymore. And it doesn't matter whether it's Fitbit, Whoop, or Apple Watch, or Oring, does not matter. It's going to be our personalized healthcare device, and the change in healthcare will come from new players doing completely new things. This is where I see the solution to the current crisis in the medicine.
Well, two of the things you talk about that I love, because so many longevity investors really don't talk about it, are number one, we have to make life such that people want to extend it. Number one, that's very, very important. I'm glad you mentioned that. And then number two, there are economic questions about access, and you seem to be addressing both in the book, which I think is great.
Thank you, David. Yeah, it's very important. Like in the US, you know, two zip codes next to each other had 15 years of difference in the lifespan. I couldn't find even, you know, logical or rational explanation behind that, you know, a part of inequality gap that we have in this world. I mean, it's, and the US is not an exception. Like in London, you know, this same situation will give you, in some of the cases, 17 years difference. Well, that's why I'm embracing technology. We're investing in technology to democratize access to healthcare, like decreasing the cost of cancer diagnostic by 2, 5, 10 times, decreasing the cost of ultrasound diagnostic by 10 times. And this is real numbers from the startups that we funded, or decreasing the cost of organ transplantation, like liver transplantation, by 10 times. So I'm very hopeful that this will give us an opportunity for all of us to be as brave as thinking of healthcare as a basic good and basic service, which would need to be provided to everyone for free of charge. This is my dream.
The book is The Science and Technology of Growing Young. We've been speaking with the book's author, Sergey Young. Sergey, so great having you on. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, David. Stay healthy and happy, please.